Get your Bibles and go to Ephesians 6:16. This is Spiritual Warfare 107. I'm also going to include it in the Last Day series. I think we're up to number 9 in that series. Because tonight's message is going to touch on both subjects. So those of you who are doing the summaries, when you go to the archives, make sure you get both. Spiritual Warfare 107, or Last Day series, number 9. Now, I'm still on verse 16. Above all, literally in all, taking the shield, or take up the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench or extinguish all the fiery darts. Literally, it could be darts, missiles, javelins, arrows. I like arrows. Of the wicked. I'm still on this verse. In all, take up the shield of faith. And I told you to write down the word there used for faith is pistis. P-I-S-T-I-S. Pistis. One of the things I'm going to like about the new website, I think we'll be able to get accomplished, is I'll be able to ask you questions throughout the week. And if you elect to do so, you can answer them. So I get a feel on certain subject matters, what the listening audience knows about a particular subject. So I know where to concentrate the efforts in the message. Like I said, this is how you participate. I don't have you sitting in front of me, so I can see your eyes, whether you're getting it or not, or you understand what I'm doing or not. So it requires communication. Pistis. P-I-S-T-I-S. What is pistis? Well, I told you in previous message on the spiritual warfare, I believe, that pistis comes from P-E-I-T-H-O. Peto or pito, which means to persuade. Persuaded by what you heard to be true. In this case, tonight, as all other nights, God's Word. Pistis is a subject. I mean, an object or a noun. And it comes from the word to persuade someone. Now, I also gave you the definition of pisteo. I'm going to combine all these tonight and rewrite 11:1. Not that I think it's missing anything, but put it in a form that you can understand it. Pisteo, P-I-S-T-E-U-O, P-I-S-T-E-U-O. Now, that's a verb. It's an action word. It requires action. Simply, I give you the definition, is to trust and have confidence, in our case, in Jesus Christ and His Word, which, by the way, is how we obtain righteousness. As I've said many times over, the Holy Spirit will not dwell in anything that's righteous, and we can't make ourselves righteous. Only Christ can do that. We'll fall short. Our righteousness would be classified as filthy rags, according to Scripture. And it falls short. So that's pisteo. Now, with those definitions, let's read this verse. I told you, most of it will go right over your head because you're not taught this. whether they don't see it or whether they don't understand what these Greek words mean in practicality. In all, take up the shield of faith. What Christ has asked us to do is start the first level of faith, as I said so many times. It's the first level of faith. It's what gets us off the starting blocks. Pistis. Pistis meaning what you heard to be true. Or what you heard, you were persuaded that it was the truth. It was the truth. Salvation. It's the truth. Salvation comes through the power of the blood. Because the Lamb of God was slain for our benefit. You start, the seed of faith is planted in your being, and you are persuaded that what you're listening to now is the truth. And that's the beginning stages of faith. God knows we're in a roller coaster as human beings. We have good days, we have bad days. We have some days that we're fading more than others. But the only requirement for the shield of faith is to be at the starting blocks. Not necessarily at the pisteo level. Go back. Remember what you heard to be the truth when you heard it. And start from there. And automatically, we have a shield. As I said before, and I used the Star Trek, the Enterprise ship, as an example. When the captain said, shields up, it just didn't cover the front of the ship or the back of the ship. It encircled the ship. It encompassed the ship. The ship was totally protected from every side and every angle. And that's what this shield of faith is all about. Christ's protection that he has given us when we come up against an enemy that's fierce. That's fierce. I'm going to take us to Revelation 12, and that will be part of the Last Days series connection. To make us understand why none of these pieces in this armor should be missing. Because the attack is stronger now than ever. So we have pistis. All we have to do is remember what we heard when we heard it. And remember, the seed of faith was planted in you, and you faith it to be true because you were persuaded by what you heard. That's back to Romans 10. I was not going to go there, but let's go real quick. Romans 10, 17. What does it say? So then faith cometh by hearing. In some translations, so faith by hearing. There's only one way to receive the faith that gets you off the starting blocks, the pistis. The word is pistis there. So faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And of course, it goes on to say in the previous verses in Romans, how then in verse 14? Well, let's go back to verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Or, in this case, pisteo, faith. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not trusted and have confidence in? And how shall they believe or faith in him of whom they have not heard? How can you have pisteo unless the pistis message was preached in the first place? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And that's your responsibility in the Great Commission, to keep one going. so it can preach. And how shall they preach except they be sent? When you support this ministry, guess what? You're sending me. You're sending me. Well, God's sending me because he directed my path. But he has allowed you to be participate in that commission. And you're sending me to preach to a world. And how beautiful are the feet that preach the gospel of peace. The gospel that preaches stop being against God. Because you only have peace when you stop fighting against what God wants for you. Not only my feet are beautiful, but yours are also because you have sent me. And bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for said the Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing. So peace comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I have to preach it to persuade others. And if they're listening, hopefully, God willing, plant that seed of starting faith, let's call it that, pistis, so it takes root, and they are convinced and persuaded that what they're hearing is to be is the truth and the only truth. And as they stick around and as they grow, they will gain the pisteo faith, what I've called the so be it faith, the amen faith, as others have called it, the trust and confidence that builds up in their being, knowing, did God say that? And if they can make the connection in their life to claim that promise, then so be it. Case closed. Now that's an amazing level to be at all times. And quite frankly, I'm not there either. You go to Hebrews 11:1. I've gone there several times in this particular verse that we're studying here in Ephesians. It's worth another visit. Hebrews 11:1, and take notes on this. Now faith is a substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. I once again, even though I've done it many times over, went through all the translations, all the explanations I ever heard, and it still didn't buy me anything. Well, yeah, some of the translations and some of the explanations did help. I'm not going to discount those. But I needed something that made it a complete definition what faith is and how you get it. More importantly, how you get it. You can read this verse a million times over in the King James Version. And I did a little test. I asked several people in the course of this day, explain this verse to me. So they couldn't explain the King James, so they tried to go to other translations. It still fell short. Now faith, there the word faith is pistis again. That is the word that's used to describe someone being persuaded to believe what they heard is the truth. Now faith is a substance. Some have used this word substance, and some have defined this word substance in several different ways. One of the ways is title deed. Faith is a title deed of things hoped for. I have seen it. Now, faith is the grant for things hoped for. Faith does not give you, I don't care who you heard this from, faith does not give you a title deed over anything. Because then you have the weapon in your hand to say to God, I have a title deed because I have faith. Now, grant me what you want. What I need, excuse me, not what he wants, but what I need. Your word says, now faith is the title deed. A title deed gives you possession. Well, I can possess God's word and promises. Yes, but what happens when they don't come to pass? And I get many, many questions. That's why I'm on the subject matter night. I get many, many questions. I faith, I did this, I did that, I faith, I was a faithing Christian. And what I asked for, what I faith for, I did not receive it. And I thought I had a title deed. It was mine. It's my possession. Nothing's yours. Faith is not a genie in a bottle to do what you want to do with it. Now, faith is a substance. What should be translated there is foundation. Now, the type of faith that I've been talking about the last few minutes, preaching to you about pistis, is the foundation. As I've said over and over, it's the starting point. It's the starting point. It's what gets you out of the block in the race of faithing Christians against the world that's against us, our competition, if you want to call it that. It's not a title deed. You have to line up with God's wishes. He does not have to line up with yours. And don't go holding no legalistic definition what you think of faith is over his head. You're not the boss. I'm not the boss. We don't own him. He owns us. We could be his joint heir through Christ in his family. But every family has a head. And he's the head. Now, faith is the foundation of things hoped for. That's why title deed does not work. Title deed does not work because then you're saying, well, now faith is a title deed for things hoped for. I have a promise here. So if I keep hoping for them, God has to grant it. No, he doesn't. And I guarantee you this, he'll never deliver on something that doesn't line up with his word. Now faith is the, now pistis or faith is the foundation of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Just about every translation, but also just about every preacher I ever heard always points this to a future promise you're trying to claim. A future event you're trying to get behind you. That's not what it's saying. And this is why there's so much confusion about how to define faith. And I've heard or read all of them. I don't have some new revelation. I'm only preaching what's already been said. I'm trying to not super spiritualize it. I'm not trying to put it in a category with, oh, woo, 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 woo. How are we going to figure that one out? It's too mysterious. No, God's word is not that mysterious. Someone asked me, what do you think the most amazing miracle ever happened? The resurrection. I can't explain that away. No scientific explanation. I've showed you where even the crossing of the Red Sea, God used geological laws to create a passing. Yes, a miracle still was required, but not as great a miracle as the resurrection. We cannot explain that. We say that it happened, but we can't explain it. I could take you through a lot of Old Testament miracles and give you scientific explanations that come close or are right on, along with a partial miracle, a supernatural event, for it to come to pass. But when it comes to the resurrection, There's no explanation, scientific or any other, except the supernatural miracle of God raising his son. There might be some scientific explanation how we did it, but you're never going to believe that if you don't believe there's a God that would do it for his only begotten son. That's why the resurrection is still the biggest miracle, and it always will be. And Satan knew it. That's why he fought hard against it. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evident things of not seen. Now, let me rewrite this in your mind. You can write it down in your notes if you want to in your Bible. Now, faith is the foundation, or now pistis, one who has been persuaded by what they heard to be the truth. Write that down. Now pistis, or faith, and put a little definition of it in parentheses. One who has been persuaded by what they heard to be the truth is the foundation, is the starting point. It's the where a Christian should be. When they first hear the word of God, preach to them if the seed of faith is planted in you. Now, pistis, one who has been persuaded by what they heard to be true or by the truth, is the foundations for things. What does it say in the King James? Of things hoped for. Oh, things of hope for. Okay. Write down for things to come. Events or promises that still have not been fulfilled in your life is the foundations for things to come. Why? Why we have that hope? Because the evidence, put in parentheses after that word, proof of things not seen. And like I said earlier, everyone points to a future time of things. We're fading on things to happen, believing that they're going to happen even though we have not seen them yet. Is that what you truly believe that this scripture says? If that's what you believe, you have somebody preaching to you that shouldn't be preaching, or you didn't understand the preacher. One of the two. But that's not what this verse says. It is the foundation for things to come, future events, not yet fulfilled, whatever they are, could be promises, because of the evidence, the certainty that we have that they will come to pass, not by just looking ahead and saying in faith it's going to happen. No, of things not seen. What things? The proof of things not seen. What proof? Right here in my hands. We live at a moment in history where 99.99% of everything's been fulfilled. The ages of time are just about at its completion. We have the proof of things not seen. We weren't there when Jesus rose from the dead. We weren't there for all the stories that took place. We just faith it to be true. We, in this case, hopefully you're at the pisteo level in this matter. You have the trust and confidence what this book is telling us is the truth, and you have been acting upon the truth. This is the only time in Scripture we can really look back, because we're really not to look back and say, oh, those days, or only if I lived in that time, because you're really insulting the Christ that has you in the time that he wants you to participate in. But this is the only time we get to look back at the proof of the evidence that we did not see. But yet, because we pieced this, heard it, we believe it to be true, and because of how we have claimed those promises and how it's affected our everyday life as we march along this race that we're in for eternity, we have seen things come to pass. Well, what about Adam and Eve? What about the Cain and Abel and their sons and daughters? What about those people? They didn't have all that evidence. Did they? Or didn't they? To think they didn't is foolish. Adam walked and talked with God. Why do you think the punishment was so severe? Adam knew more than all of us combined, probably. I don't think he was a very good teacher, because it was his responsibility to make sure Eve knew. But nevertheless, you don't think Abel, Cain, their sons and daughters didn't have the opportunity to learn probably from the one that knew the most? All the experiences they had, you think Adam and Eve were in the garden for 15 minutes and boom, they sinned? No. Walked and talked with God. And the last time I checked, God is not no one-minute conversationalist. When he wants to drive something home, he keeps on going. They had the opportunity to learn from someone that knew so much knowledge, so many experiences because of the fall. There's never been an excuse. But now in our time, there's less of an excuse than there ever has been in history. Now, pistis, one who has been persuaded by what they heard to be true, is the foundation. The foundation, listen, you're going to build a tower. You're going to make sure the foundation is strong enough to hold that tower. Is the foundation the starting point for things to come, things that we have not yet seen or has been fulfilled or promises still unclaimed, because we have that hope. Why? Because of the evidence, the proof of things not seen is not sometime in the future, but things of not seen of things that we did not experience in the past, but we can faith it to be true because we have a record of it. And that leads me to the last. Not the last, but there's more. Pistos. P-I-S-T-O-S. Pistos. I haven't touched that yet. That's an adjective. What is an adjective? It's a modifier. What is a modifying nouns? So it's modifying, in this case, pistis. What is pistis? Because time is running by, or going by really quick. One who's continuing to be faithful. One who's continuing to be faithful in what? In hearing the word of God, which increases more confidence and trust in the Lord and His word. And His word. What I like to call the ever-increasing faithers. So after this message, I want you to write to me or call and let me know if you understand the differences, even though they're gelled together, but the differences of pistis, pisteo, and pistos. Now, pistis, one who has been persuaded by what they heard to be true, is the foundation for things to come that we're still claiming, because why we're claiming and have hope in it? Because the evidence, the proof of things not seen, not some we're fading for this to happen, of things not seen. No, we have the evidence. That's what we're fading upon. Listen to me. You, who you that are out there listening to me that have a job, you work for an employer, usually you get paid in arrears in most cases. So in faith that you have in that employer, you'll put out all your efforts, your toil, your labor, your sweat, whatever, your time, in the hope that you'll be paid in a week, two, or a month, whatever the pay cycle is for your employer. And what do you base that upon? By the record and how it's been done in the past. You think there'd be many people working for anyone these days if there was no record of the past of how someone would be paid in the future and how it's guaranteed? Think about it, folks. This verse, as so many preachers have done, the latter part of it, the evidence of things not seen, puts your hope in something that you haven't seen yet. And you are to put your hope in something you have not seen yet. But not based on some fickle faith, based upon the evidence that's already happened in history, that we have a record of it. Like I said, we live in a time with no excuse. No excuse. So I wanted tonight to come to you with an understanding that Hebrews 11:1 is full of riches from God's word. And that's why you think it's by accident, then Paul goes on to give you a whole chapter of fathers, heroes of faith. He's not looking forward for the record, the evidence. He's looking in the past to give hope for the future. Let me know if you got that. Now with it, I'll go back to Ephesians 6:16. Above all, or in all, take up the shield of peace. God in his compassion gave us a suit of armor which include the shield that encompasses us without us even getting to the so be it faith. Because he knew as soon as we even expressed that we are saved through the power of the blood of the Lamb, Satan will go to work immediately. So he wanted us to be equipped with the weapons that can fight him off. The spiritual weapons, wherewith we shall be able to extinguish all those fiery darts, missiles, arrows of the wicked. But why is it so important to know this? Why you spend so much time in spiritual warfare? You go to Revelation chapter 12. Listen, this is where it's kind of related to the last day series. I left off in the last day series on verse 6, chapter 12. And there's some preaching when I'm preaching. It's no new truth on a last day series. But I've combed everything. You guarantee I could comb. One thing I could do is comb through material that's available. And I'm not talking about stuff that just generalizes it or just gives you a sentence or two about any subject matter or a paragraph or two. I'm talking about serious material. And there's a few out there that are preaching it. Some are already dead and have preached it. Dead in the body, but not dead in the spirit. But I noticed in all the last day prophecy teachers, they skip verse 7 through 13. And it puzzled me, even though there's not many of them. All of them, without exception, avoids this particular chapter. Verse 7 through 13. And I said, what a shame. What a shame. That's why I don't recommend many things. I can respect someone that preaches it and then finds out later, well, you know what? Thank God God's gave me a different perspective on it, and now I have to change my point of view because I have grown in my knowledge of what His Word has declared. There is no room for egos in the preaching of the Word of God. Even though I knew this, have told you that our accuser is sitting there in the courts of heaven accusing us. Knowing the fact that you weren't ready for the truth that I'm laying down now, especially when I started preaching on spiritual warfare, well, 2+ years ago, even sooner than that, you weren't ready. I had to lay down about 300 messages for you to hear this message tonight. Because once again, you've been told, you've been preached to, you've read, including the preachers that have some common denominator, what I do here. But you've never been told what the truth is concerning 12:7-13. Why? They just don't see it. They don't understand. Well, they understand the concept of spiritual warfare, but they don't recognize the application through it, not just Book of Revelation, by the way, through all of God's Word. At every turn, there is spiritual warfare taking place. Why we need to have the armor and the shield of faith? Because Satan's loose. He's now constricted to this earth. Well, I never heard that. Because finally I can now preach it to you correctly. With having the background of 300 plus messages. So you don't think I'm some kind of lunatic or nut. I know some of you are saying out there, well, I never thought of that. Yeah, you would. It's hard to break down traditional walls. And there was war in heaven. Now, all prophecy teachers, even the prophecy teachers that I have a common denominator with, even preach this. I'm going, what? How can you be right and then so wrong? That's why I said. That's what I've been saying to you. Be careful when you go out there. All it does is take this much. A twinkling of an eye, really, almost. A little longer than that, but to bring you in a state of confusion and doubt about what's being preached. What you're hearing, what you thought you were hearing to be true, but because of the lack of spiritual insight. I'm not boasting, folks. As I told you many times over, God forbid if I'm the only one. Do I think that? Absolutely not. I know that for a fact. First of all, isn't at the end of the time there's going to be 144,000 are marked? I haven't got to that yet, but that's another time. Before I get too far off track here, let me go back. And there was war in heaven. Remember, this is after verse 1 through 6, where the woman gives birth to a son. It talks about the woman, the 12 stars, the red dragon, that being Satan, the third part of stars in heaven, that being the fallen angels that followed Satan in the rebellion, the man-child, which being Jesus. And then we get the woman fleeing into the wilderness for 1260 days, which I told you what that represented already in the last day series message previous to this one. Verse 7, let's pick it up now. This is why you need spiritual armor. This is why you need the encompassing shield of faith. And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. Dragon there being Satan once again. And the dragon fought at it and his angels. The war of all wars, by the way. And prevailed not. Who prevailed not? Satan. Literally, and not having power any longer in the heavens. Neither was there place found any more in heaven for Satan. Like I said, all prophecy teachers put, without exception, this in the future. I'm telling you, it's already been fulfilled. This is the reason. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent. That snake. Cast out. Kicked out by Michael and his assisting angels that fought against Satan and his assisting angels. They were kicked out. That old serpent called devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth. Where was he cast into? The earth. Where do we dwell? Here on earth. And his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren, I don't care who you listen to, including this preacher, knowing very well that someday I would be preaching against my own message. I look back at it. Do I have regrets preaching a message that we have an accuser of the brethren in heaven? You look at the Job message. Yes and no. Yes, I regret it because I really wanted to tell you what truly is going on. But no, I couldn't at the time because this ministry was first being established. In that Job message, I think it was preached in the first 4 or 5 months of this ministry and had very few followers of it. It's not like that any longer, but still, the few followers that were following would have said, what a nut. Well, now you know the truth, and I have no problem correcting my own self. Ego is left at the door when it comes to God's word. And I heard a loud voice saying, in heaven now has come salvation and strength, dynamic power and strength. How did that salvation come? Because Michael and his angels kicked them out? No. Because Christ came with what? With his blood presented to him by the Father. What Michael has been waiting for. I'm going to really play a song if you lost me. Play a song.
By grace,
They tell me we had a power failure where the servers are located. I'm up now. I still want confirmation from you out there that you are hearing me and seeing me before I go any further. Run them into me so I know that you're out there. You think it's by accident? I'm touching territory that has never been touched before that I can find. I am fighting and you are fighting. It's a prince of the power of the air that's seeking to destroy this ministry and the message it's putting out. Those of you who listen and watch have never been brought to a time period in your life that will make the impact in these last days that needs to be made. I feel like that Old Testament saint when he says arise, when literally it says wake up. What does it take to wake you up to understand what we are up against? I'm getting messages now saying I'm back up. I know exactly where I lost you, so I'll go to the point where I was before I went down. You think that Satan wants you to listen to this message tonight? He knows he's being exposed like he's never been exposed before. He knows the plans that we have behind the scenes to take this last days series message out to a world and what we're trying to do to accomplish that. That's why I ask for your prayers and the people around me. We're being bombarded by the prince of the power of the air. And you need to wake up. No, I'm going to continue where I left off. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not, or not having power. Power to what? To defeat Michael and his angels. Why? As I said before, it went down. Because they had something in their arsenal now also. The blood of the Lamb. And that great dragon was cast out. Let me tell you something right now, folks. You think, can God give supernatural power to Michael and his angels that did not fall to defeat Satan and his angels? Absolutely. Who's boxing God in? But what we know is what Scripture has told us. Christ's blood was not only salvation for us, but salvation for the heavenlies, because they now don't have to deal with Satan any longer, because he's been cast down to the earth. And the great dragon and prevailed not, not having power, neither was their place found anymore in heaven. They were kicked out, period. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent, that old snake, called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth. This is now the only domain he resides in. Well, how do you know that? Stick around. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. This is not some future prophecy that still needs to be fulfilled. It's been fulfilled. And I heard a loud voice singing in heaven, now is come salvation and strength, dynamic power, and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. As I said, even I have to correct myself, knowing that what I preached to you 4 years ago, you wouldn't accept it, so I had no choice in my eyes. Because the very few of you that followed at that time would have said I was a nut if I would declare we don't have an accuser any longer in the heavenlies, in the court of heaven, as I pointed out in Spiritual Warfare, I think, 2 or 3. No, he's not there any longer. He's kicked out. Well, I thought this was, and I've been told all my life, it's some future event at the last 7-year period. Well, you know what? Stop listening to who you've been listening to. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and loved not their lives unto the death, unto death. The ones that came with Christ, and I've preached this before in a spiritual warfare series, in the beginning part of that series, how Christ took with him all the Old Testament saints, and they marched behind him, following him in his blood, and they came with their word and testimony, that even if they had to die for the cause of God, they died. They would not lose that testimony and faith in him. And Satan, once Christ arrived in the courts of heaven, knew he was defeated and knew what Michael's been waiting for, the blood, is only strength that he needed, him and his angels, now to overcome an angel that was created even stronger than he was. He was the chief angel. He was the angel that was telling all the other angels what to do. You get the picture, folks? I'm talking about Satan now. But what Satan didn't have in his arsenal was the blood of Christ. That's why he not only cleansed sinners here on earth, but it also cleansed the heavenies of the impurities that Satan was leaving wherever he was going, especially in the court of heaven as the accuser. So I now can tell you, I can correct myself finally by saying, no, there is no longer an accuser in heaven. That's why I'm going to have to preach Job again now. Now that from a reference, because for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. I believe all spiritual beings, all beings, period, that now exist in the heavenlies, finally was saying, thank God for Christ. We follow him up here. The blood of the Lamb got us here, and the heavenly beings, the angels, and who whatever, said, thank you, Lord, for the power of your Son, which now gives us the power to cleanse, to clean house on Satan and his cronies. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. But woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. Of the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, nothing's excluded. For the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath. He's furious. Why? First of all, he doesn't have access any longer to accuse us. Just think about it. Why would he keep accusing? The devil is not that stupid. Why would he keep it excusing? No, the price has been paid. You think the devil would be smarter than that, knowing that his accusations would fall on deaf ears, because any time that he would accuse, he would have to go through the blood himself. And he knew that was not any exhibit A to stand on. his accusations. So why would he waste time when his goal is to defeat God's chosen? Some of you need to wake up. Traditions have made void the word of God. Doctrines have made void the word of God. Dear, rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. But woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. The devil's come down unto you having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. A short time. It doesn't say times there, by the way. Time. I'll have more to say that in the future. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. Who's he talking about there? Israel and the Jews. He made a beeline. And he went to work. Just years, a few years after Christ's death, Jerusalem fell because of the Romans. 600 years later, give or take, they lost total control, couldn't even worship there any longer without the fear of death in the holy city of Jerusalem. Not to mention the persecution the Jewish people have suffered, including the time of Jacob's trouble. Why? Because of Satan's wrath. He made a beeline, as Scripture says, to the man-child. Other Scriptures also include Christians, faithing Christians, that are a joint heir with Christ. And when the dragon saw that he was cast down to the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. That's been taking place. And it took place all the way up to 1947. That's a fact. A verifiable fact. Biblical history and secular history. It's a fact. It ain't no time in the future. God ordered Michael and his angels, because he knew that Michael now had the arsenal, the weaponry, the precious blood of Jesus Christ in his arsenal, that will defeat even a being more powerful than him. And he kicked them out under God's orders. And he no longer dwells in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ as an accuser. What an insult to Christ if his father, after what Christ went through, allowed Satan there to accuse. If I was Jesus, I said, hello, what did I do this for? Shut his mouth. Kick him out of here. Am I being simple enough to make the point? But we'll go ahead and listen to the Christian science fiction that's being preached, that's been formulated into doctrines, to think that this has been happening, this is going to be happening sometimes in the future. Tell the Jews that! They would think you're a nut. You have some kind of form of amnesia regarding history. It's happened. Satan's been kicked out. He is here for a season, which started when Christ came with his blood into the heavenlies, the heaven's court, the heavenly courts, saying, no more accusations. I finished what I needed to do to set them free from your accusations. So get the hell out of here. Get behind me and understand you'll still have a season. You'll still have a short time. But that's what's going to be, a short time. And Satan immediately went to work on destroying the Jewish people because he wanted them eliminated completely. Eliminated completely. In other verses also describes he wants to eliminate Christians. He doesn't want any of the chosen by God to be in the heavenlies where there is no accusations. Satan is alive and well, as they say. He's here on earth. Him and all his fallen angel cronies and demons, they're not one and the same, as I taught already in the spiritual warfare series. They are in the air. Proof of that is just when I was just getting to the point presenting what has happened to them, we got kicked off the air. But I'm determined to finish this message tonight. He is the prince of power of the air. He knows his time is short. He went immediately working on the Jews and Christians to try to defeat him. He wasn't successful. Tell the Christians, in the New Testament early days, the first few hundred years, there was not no persecution. There was not no devil's wrath on this earth. You sit in your comfortable chairs. Not all of you. Some of you know the truth. But those of you who are still hanging on to those old traditions, complain when you have a bellyache. You take something for it to relieve it. Think you're being under some type of persecution. No. Most of us have never experienced that type of persecution. Now listen to me tonight. It's real. It's happened. It's still happening in parts of this world as I read you messages from India and Africa where Christians are being persecuted by Muslims and Hindus. Killed. Beheaded. Burned alive. Satan's wrath is taking place in areas that he knows that he can really persecute Christians to the point of death, hoping that they will turn on their Lord whom they serve. And for countries that have certain laws that we have to follow and things like that are not permitted, he goes to work on you different ways, but he's still coming after you, like it or lump it. I don't like it as much as you do, but it's part of the trip. It's that's why we've been provided spiritual armor for the spiritual warfare. That's why I want to finish tonight with Ephesians 6:16 again. Take all, in all, take up the shield, the peace, the hearing of the Word of God. That's why you cannot stop hearing the Word of God. I don't care how much you think you know. I don't care how much you do know. You cannot stop hearing the Word of God. And hearing takes president over than any other form of understanding of God's Word. Because if you're listening to a preacher that brings it alive in your life, there is no better way of understanding it than that. Well, I read a lot. Good! But it makes me question what you're reading, because most of it is garbage, as I said before. Trying to make you super spiritual instead of making you understand what you need to know to survive this battle that we're in. Nothing takes the place of God's order of Romans 10:17 in the previous verses. How can you hear unless a preacher sent to you? How can I preach unless you sent me? No one's excusing the Great Commission. And Satan knows it. But we're promised a shield of faith. If we keep on listening to the Word of God, even though we might slip out of pisteo faith, but as long as we have pieces faith, God has promised us a covering, a shield. Let me just close with Psalm 5. This paints the picture that I'm trying to relay to you tonight. Verse 12. For thou, Lord, will bless the righteous. I've told you how you become righteous, and that's through faith. None of your own doing or works. The righteous with favor, literally favor and grace. For thou, Lord, will bless the righteous with favor and grace. Compass him with a shield. Hebrew word is atar. It means to surround something or someone. Or crown with complete covering. When I put on the shield of faith, I know what it's doing. It's surrounding me completely. Most of you, especially guys, could probably relate this in their younger days when they're full of testosterone. When you pick a fight, you're facing your enemy. Well, Satan does not fight that way. He wants to make sure you don't see him coming. He'll attack you from the rear. He'll attack you from the bottom, the top, the side. He don't care. That's why we are blessed. The righteous ones, us, the faithing ones, with favor and grace. Why? Because Christ has compassed us. He has surrounded us in the Hebrew with a shield. And the only way we get that shield, if we keep hearing and listening to the word rightly divided. Hopefully you got the message tonight. I covered different areas in God's word. And I was interrupted by the prince of the power of the air, thinking that if he knocked me off the air tonight, I would not finish this message. Well, I got news for him. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And just as he was kicked out of the heavenlies, if I remain faithful and covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, he's not coming against me. He's coming against my Savior. And my Savior has already won the battle once. And he will continue to win the battle for all of us. If we remain pistos, faithful. Now I want to hear from you.